A warm welcome back. We will now proceed to panel one, titled Understanding the Political and Security Issues. I would like to introduce our distinguished panelists who are on stage. First, Admiral Dr. Jayanath, Colombage, Director, Center for Indo-Lanka Initiatives, Pathfinder Foundation, Sri Lanka. Next, Associate Professor Huang, Yunsong, Associate Dean, Sichuan University School of International Studies, and Coordinator, Center for South Asian Studies, Sichuan University, China. Next, Dr. Amitendu Palit, Senior Research Fellow and Research Lead, Trade and Economics at the Institute of South Asian Studies, NUS. This session will be chaired by Dr. Iftekhar Chowdhury, Principal Research Fellow, Institute of South Asian Studies, NUS, and former Foreign Minister of Bangladesh. I now hand the session over to Dr. Chowdhury.
Thank you, Taisha. As your chair of the first session, of course, I have a sad and a happy task. The sad one is, of course, declaring the tea break closed, and the happy one is announcing the commencement of the first session. A few words from the chair on the DRI, I would assume, would be in order. It is very much the essence of the Chinese President Xi Jinping's China dream, or Chungguo Man, as it is said in Mandarin. It's a part of the plan to make China a great modern socialist country by the year 2050. China will become a global leader in innovation, will narrow income gaps and make solid progress towards high quality rather than high speed prosperity. Stage two would then follow. It is that by 2050, China will become a global leader in terms of composite national strength and international influence. But China will not do all these, attempt all these alone. It will do so on a global matrix that should redound, at least in the theoretical underpinning of the concept, to the benefit of all involved. What straddles the two stages is the BRI. It is the most significant development strategy launched by Xi's government to promote economic cooperation among the countries along the way through which the initiative BRI runs, both on the land and sea. The major goals underlying the initiatives are policy coordination, facilitation of connectivity, unimpeded trade, financial integration, and the people-to-people bonds, which is extremely significant. If all goes well, China could win the confidence of the world, as implied in Xi's phrase, Yi De Fu Ren, meaning just that, as uttered earlier on an earlier occasion in Davos. But if all goes well, is always an aspiration devoutly to be wished. In such a gargantuan economic project, the largest in scale ever known to history, there are bound to be potential pitfalls. Is it possible the recipients and partners will become deeply indebted to China, unable to amortize the credits? And if so, then what? Can these societies accept, Chairman Pillay was saying earlier, the alien presence of Chinese workers and experts in large numbers, in numbers both large and small, which could be a part of the implementation of many a project? What about addressing some political and security concerns, such as going around the objections of none too enthusiastic actors and the suspicions harbored by elements even in the United States? What about the security and challenges contained in having to navigate through the rough courses in Afghanistan and even friendly Pakistan's Balochistan? Can BRI manage to skirt around the Rohingya issue that has bedeviled the politics of Myanmar and Bangladesh? Both key are BRI partners. More importantly, we need to ask ourselves that is BRI, which is at least 11 times larger than the post-World War II Marshall Plan that entirely transformed Europe, supplant the old global economic architecture or order for a new one? It has been said that there is nothing as powerful as an idea whose time has come. Does the PRI constitute such an idea? To address these and other queries, few are better equipped than the analysts on the podium who have focused their immense intellectual energies on the issue. I shall now call upon them to address the subject one by one, and the first on my list would be Admiral Dr. Jayanath Colombage, and he will speak to, and his subject is, that is, understanding the political and security issues, border and territorial issues, geostrategic and maritime security dynamics in the Indo-Pacific region. Admiral.
Good morning, everybody. It's wonderful to be here in Singapore with ISAS partnering Pathfinder, my organization. And when I see the great, highly intellectual crowd, we feel really happy that we started this process and today we are deriving the results. We had a great talk by Madam Simhan in the morning, and she spoke in length about BRI and various aspects. And from the questions coming from the audience, we saw very clearly that there is another dimension to this whole issue, and that dimension is the strategic issue. And the irony in the present day is the countries are not really able to make decisions for their benefit purely on economic terms. They will have to consider the strategic aspirations of the regional, extra-regional powers before they can make decisions for the betterment of their country. So my focus in the first talk is about geostrategic and maritime dynamics of the Indian Ocean, mainly from the Sri Lankan point of view. It was mentioned repeatedly that the linkage with ASEAN and South Asia, so we consider that we are in a very important location in South Asia. And if I have to describe this particular region in 6 words, I would say this is a region of strategic competition, strategic convergences, and strategic dilemma. Strategic competition among the major powers, strategic convergence, some major powers against some, and the strategic dilemma for countries small, less powerful, less economically and militarily powerful countries like Sri Lanka. One thing is sure, the unprecedented rise of China, and economically and militarily, and China's presence in the Indian Ocean is reality. And so is the high rise of India to be the number 7th economic position in the world and still rising, number 3 biggest military in the world, and one of the most populous countries and rising. Now the situation is, when these two powers, their economy and the military, is expanding, their spheres of influence come into contact. Now unfortunately, this contact is taking place in the Indian Ocean. To be more precise, the highest intensity of this conflict is taking place around South Asia, even if you go further around Sri Lanka. So that's the kind of a predicament that Sri Lanka is in. Now, United States is a key player in the Indian Ocean, and they clearly identify in their national security strategy that China is their adversary. And if you remember a speech made by the Secretary of State, Mr. Tillerson, in the month of October in Washington, he spoke about the same thing. He said, for India and USA, China is the common adversary. And he said, we need a 100-year partnership, a strategic partnership with India. Now, if it came from India, we can understand. But now here, USA, the major power, is asking India to be a strategic partner for 100 years, whereas India is around 70 years old as of now as a country. But to me, This is an indication of the things to come in the Indian Ocean. Now the USA, declining power, so they want to partner with other players to basically to keep China off and to ensure that their presence is maintained. Now, in this situation, the Indian Ocean has become a heavily militarized ocean. If I share with you a figure, Port of Colombo from 2009 to 2017, 399 warships have visited Port of Colombo. Well, it is good business for us, and it also indicates that we have a free port, and these 399 ships belong to 28 countries. It's not limited to one particular country, but it also gives you a feeling of the military presence in the Indian Ocean. And also, not only the ordinary warships, but there are other submarines as well. And not only the submarines, there are offensive platforms like aircraft carriers, nuclear submarines, and platforms carrying intercontinental ballistic missiles with nuclear warheads. Everything is in the Indian Ocean in a large scale. Now, therefore, I would argue that there is an undeclared maritime Cold War coming up in the Indian Ocean. Now, this Cold War is not a declared one like the one we saw in Europe, but this is an undeclared Cold War. Now, increasingly, we also see, especially in the Indian Ocean, the maritime commons, which is a global common for the global trade, is increasingly contested between major players. And we need to worry about many things in our region, about food security, environmental security, climate impact, global warming, sea level rising, poverty elevation. But our main focus is military development or the military threats in the Indian Ocean. Now, the security of some states can mean insecurity for others. So that is exactly happening in the Indian Ocean, and there is arms race in the Indian Ocean. Everybody wants to build their navies, militaries, by weapons, by platforms, diverting the money which is essential to the development of the region and also to the development of the people. Now, we also see that from the Tillerson speech and the American trend, that there is a gradual weakening, or there is a kind of a fatigue from the US to be the global policeman. That's why they want other players like India, Japan, Australia to be partnering them. So when there is a relative decline on the US power, there are other countries waiting to fill that, like China and India and Japan and Australia, to name a few. Well, ladies and gentlemen, the globalization, the technology has really connected us, but we are not yet connected in the ocean security. We maintain our own security. However, the sustenance of the entire world depends on the ocean, and we all know that in the 21st century, Indian Ocean and the Pacific Oceans are becoming the key oceans in the world. If you take the Indian Ocean, 50% of container traffic, 80% of energy, 35% of bulk cargo is transported across the Indian Ocean for the whole world. So you can imagine, if that is interrupted, what will be the result? But we feel that this maritime domain or the maritime commons is increasingly getting contested, increasingly becoming insecure due to the major power rivalry. Especially in the Indian Ocean, it is not the state versus state which we have to be worried about. There are a large number of non-state actors, be they terrorists, religious extremists, human drug weapon smugglers, illegal fishers. There are various number of non-state actors influencing the Indian Ocean. To cite one example, a small group of Somali pirates were able to take the entire world shipping into ransom. And Sri Lanka is a country who suffered most at the hand of non-state actors, whether it is in terrorism or every conceivable form of maritime crime. So therefore, regulating these non-state actors is of critical importance in the Indian Ocean. Now they operate with such impunity. As such a small group like LDTP, they were able to have their front officers in practically every country in the region. And they used international ports, they used international shipping lines, not to do the legal business, but to transport huge quantities of artillery rounds, weapons, tons of explosives in this Indian Ocean and the Western Pacific. How was that possible under our own eyes? So therefore, ladies and gentlemen, one of the major problems that we have in the Indian Ocean is the maritime blindness. That means we do not see what is happening in the great span of the ocean. It is not really the states do not see. It is some people out there don't want us to see them. It is estimated by the International Maritime Organization, 57% of merchant vessels flying in the Indian Ocean do not report their position accurately. And the same United Nations says 40% of fishing taking place in the Indian Ocean is illegal. That is a clear indication as to how much we know about this Indian Ocean. So in that sense, I think the maritime domain awareness to know what is happening in the Indian Ocean is critically important. And right now, India, Sri Lanka and Maldives have established a trilateral cooperation on sharing information on white shipping. Now I think we need to explore the possibility of expanding it eastward and westward to cover the Indian Ocean at least. Then also, I like to share my thoughts on the quadrilateral. There is a concept developing, Australia, Japan, India and America. Do we need a quad? I mean, we have many organizations in the Indian Ocean and the Pacific. We have IOWA, we have IONS, we have ASEAN. So do we need another few alphabets to be added to this alphabetical soup is a question. What will it actually do? Will it not really legitimize the Cold War? Because you have four major players on one side. Who is going to be on the other side? Is it China? Probably Pakistan. But Sri Lanka will play a neutral role because we have been playing that role. And also, ladies and gentlemen, another important thing to remember is our region is given names by outsiders. Now, earlier it was Asia-Pacific, and about 2015, they called us Indo-Asia-Pacific. Now they call us Indo-Pacific. These are not the terminology that we use to describe ourselves. These are the terminology that some outside powers are using. So what does Indo-Pacific mean? Does it mean all the littorals in the Indian Ocean, or does it mean only India and the Pacific? Why is it called Indo-Pacific? Is it to keep China out? Take America in? So these are the questions that we should ask when we hear some terminology in this regard. Then I will not be really focusing much on the Western Pacific because it's a contested area, it's an enclosed area. The situation is too different between the Indian Ocean and the Western Pacific. Indian Ocean is quite open sea space. And of course, Indian for America in Indo-Pacific may be one, but for Indian Ocean littorals, we feel the Indian Ocean is too big, so we divide it into two called Western Indian Ocean and the Bay of Bengal as the two regions. Now, two different personalities. The Western Indian Ocean is a kind of a troubled area, so many hot spots are there, so many volatile areas are there. And whereas the Bay of Bengal is the most peaceful ocean space right now in the whole world, I would say. Nothing, no disputes, everything is very calm. And that is why we find the BIMSTEC, after 20 years of existence, has a renewed focus on maritime security, maritime connectivity in the Bay of Bengal. Now, I think we need to find a way to connect Western Indian Ocean and the Bay of Bengal more effectively. Right now we are connected through oil and also through Islam. But then we need to look beyond that and connect these two regions in the Indian Ocean to act as one region. And in that sense, today's topic, the Belt and Road Initiative, I see as an opportunity to connect. I see as an opportunity to connect. We heard quite a lot from the Madam Seaman, how it can be seen as a connector. So even we share the same feeling to connect this Western Indian Ocean and the Bay of Bengal. So we need to work together. We need to make things happen. Of course, China is coming to the center stage. I don't think anyone can stop it. They are here. They are in the Indian Ocean. You can't remove China from the equation. But China has to, address the concerns that it is being raised in the region again. Now, there are many talks about the requirement of a new regional maritime security architecture. The Indian leadership has been talking about it. Sri Lankan leadership has been talking about it, about the new Indian Ocean order, a new regional maritime security architecture, a new regional maritime security network. Some people even call it a code of conduct. But then a code of conduct for major players is almost an impossible task in the Indian Ocean, because there are different ambitions of the great powers, and there is huge mutual suspicion among the major players, and there is a huge inequality, there is a gap. But I believe if we can achieve some kind of an agreement, it is in the best interest of the Indian Ocean and also to the Western Pacific. Now, we heard in the morning the zero-sum game and the win-win situation, and it should not be that one party winning twice, right? It should be win-win for all the parties, but we have to be very careful, and we really need to develop trust among ourselves. We don't trust, we have a trust deficiency, especially in the Indian Ocean. And there are other threats that we need to address through some kind of mechanism. It can be environmental threats, energy security, countering terrorism and radicalization, cyber security. My friend will be talking about cyber security. So we need to combine politics and security the way we are combining economic and trade. And I believe in that sense, the ASEAN and the IORA, the International, the Indian Ocean Ring Association, and IOMS, because we have another problem in the Indian Ocean. If you take IORA, Pakistan is not a member of IORA. But if you take IOMS, Pakistan is a member, and America is not even having observer state. So I see that we need the confluence of ASEAN, IORA, and IOMS to address. I don't believe that we need another organization to address this issue, but I think the way forward is ASEAN, IORA, and IOMS. And then, ladies and gentlemen, let me come to the Sri Lankan perspective. Sri Lanka, consider, I heard the madam saying Singapore is a small country. But to me, Singapore is not a small country. Although maybe in the square area you are small, maybe in population you are small, but Singapore is a power to reckon with. And similarly, I think Sri Lanka has to get out of this mentality that we are a small country. We have many advantages, and everybody says the Pacific Commander addressing the seminar called Dialogue, Admiral Harry Harris, said Sri Lanka has three advantages in the Indian Ocean: location, location, and location. So this is why we are now attracting a lot of attention to Sri Lanka, and we are close to India. India is developing fast, and we need to really benefit, being a product of Indian economy, and we are close to the busiest shipping route, like the Malacca Strait, where all the ships are passing through. We are close to the busiest shipping route in the east-west trade in the Indian Ocean, where approximately 300 ships pass every day. So this attention of major players is a concern, and we actually call this the pretty girl syndrome. There is a pretty girl sitting in the southern tip of Indian subcontinent. Everyone is attracted to her. America is giving a warship. India is building two warships, giving us one free. Japan is building three warships, giving two free. And a lot of attention is coming, and there are high level visits, large number of ships visiting Sri Lanka. So this pretty girl is also flirting sometimes, give a smile here and there, but not committing to anyone. So finally, she might end up selecting the best partner, although in worst case scenario, she may lose everyone. So that is the predicament that Sri Lanka is right now in. So ladies and gentlemen, Sri Lanka Sri Lanka is appointed by the IORA as the lead country to come out with maritime safety and maritime security. So in this regard, let me share with you something happened in the 1971. Indian Ocean as a zone of peace. East. That was an idea mooted by then Prime Minister of Sri Lanka in Tanzania. It was approved by the United Nations General Assembly, but it did not succeed because some major powers were not in favor of it. But if you really look at it, some of the things that were said, in the Indian Ocean, they did not want this high power military rivalry to continue. They wanted to remove some military infrastructure, and basically the third line is the IOPS, the Indian Ocean as a Zone of Peace, MPCA, free and unimpeded access to all ships and aircraft in the Indian Ocean in accordance with law. And if you fast track to 2018, this is exactly what we are looking for now. So in that sense, IOPS concept was a missed opportunity. If we had that, we would not be in this situation. So now, Pathfinder, the organization that I represent, we have come out with a document called the Code of Conduct for IORA members to handle the non-state actor threat. Because if we come to, develop a code of conduct for major players, it will never be a successful story. So we thought we must try the local level, that is the IORA, to handle the non-state actors. So basically, we want to create a discussion on this regional maritime security architecture, at least addressing one particular issue, that is the threat posed by the non-state actors. And thereafter you can think of, but you see, Indian Ocean is vast. Having one architecture may not be really a reality, may not be a possibility. So we may have to think of a regional, mini-regional or bilateral way to start with and move forward. And we believe that Sri Lanka can be a center for maritime domain awareness and can be a center for humanitarian assistance and disaster relief, and also a center for research. The advantages that Sri Lanka is having, one thing is the location, the other one is accessibility. To Sri Lanka, anyone can come. Whether if you are Pakistan, India, China, America, everybody comes to Sri Lanka. But then that is a huge advantage that Sri Lanka is having. So we believe that we can play a role, though we are smaller in size, we can play a bigger role in the world, in the Indian Ocean, especially today. Now also, we are very well connected in the region. I mean, we are not yet a maritime hub as such, but if you take the South Asian region, we are the container hub in the region. But we can, I mean, we have the aspiration, we have the favorable conditions to be a maritime hub and to be a financial center in the region, not to compete with Singapore and Dubai, but to cooperate and collaborate with Singapore and Dubai. So, and also we are uniquely positioned between SAARC and BIMSTEC. You know, one side of, or not really one side, the whole of Sri Lanka is in SAARC, and part of us is in BIMSTEC. So we believe that we can play a role in that as well. So ladies and gentlemen, I come to the conclusion, and my conclusion is that we need a regional solution to the regional problems. The moment we have outside players dealing with the region and dictating terms and creating their own strategic environment, we will have problems. So in that sense, I believe IORA, IONS and the ASEAN is the way forward in maintaining maritime security and controlling the maritime strategic environment in the Indian Ocean as well as the Pacific Ocean, but especially on the Western Pacific. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Admiral. Very well argued presentation. You talked of Indian Ocean as a zone of peace to the earlier generation, and Ambassador Bernard Gunatilaka and I, among many others, for many, many years pursued this as a chimera almost. It was a Sri Lanka initiative, and I'm glad to see that Sri Lanka is once again producing, providing intellectual leadership to the second genre of the same issue. Initially, the principal actors were the United States and the Soviet Union, and tells you how times have changed. Today is no longer the United States, or United States perhaps, no longer the Soviet Union, certainly, but China and perhaps. as India come to the fore, and that's very interesting, I think. The next speaker on my list is from China. He's from Sichuan University, Associate Professor Huang Yunsong, and he'll speak to from connectivity to sovereignty, cybersecurity, and the professor.
Thank you, Chair. Distinguished guests, fellow scholars, and friends, and I'm very happy to be here to share some of my views about cybersecurity in relation to BRI. Firstly, it's cyber connectivity suddenly become a concern. Factoring the threats to cybersecurity, the connectivity plan BRI raised a red flag amongst the southern Western nation states. Threats to cybersecurity are cataloged in five categories: cyber criminals, cyber spies, nation state, cyber warriors, hackers, and terrorists. Cyberspace is vulnerable due to inherent deficiency and mismanagement. Three great weaknesses are indicated as the most challenging: inadvertent or intentional acts of insiders, supply chain flaws that permits insertion of malicious software and hardware during the acquisition process, and unknown vulnerabilities that has no established fix. Taking Belt and Road Initiative as the contextual scenario, the crux of my topic is most probably expected to rest upon security rather than development. Or more exactly, will BRI's cyber connectivity resulting increasing cyber espionage or cyber attacks from China? Sorry to let you down, I decided not to take this direction head on because it sounds very much like a question during a Congress hearing or interrogation, and it is also way beyond my knowledge. I would like to start with the mass surveillance practice. After the sudden fallout of Edward Snowden episode in June 2013, two important revelations about it came into the notice of the public. Firstly, most of the global population is exposed to the overwhelming mass surveillance of their own or foreign governments unless they are completely disconnected from the outside. According to statistics, there are 52 government mass surveillance projects run by at least 10 countries, independently or jointly. Some of these projects dated back to the 1950s, 47 of them accounting for over 90% of all are led by democracies that regard themselves as holding a high moral ground of all time. This can be just a fracture of reality if another Snowden-like whistleblower finally decides to succumb to his or her conscience. Secondly, many Western business giants in the field of telecommunication, internet-related service, and products have been involuntarily or voluntarily involved in this practice. It is simple to presume that on the issue, there are no match of state actors like the NSA of the US or the government communication headquarters of the UK. This is especially true when those intelligence agencies approach the legislative and the judiciary branches for help for the reasons of national security. On the same list of these projects, cooperators in the United States, we found Verizon, AT&T, Sprint, Apple, and Google. Some of them not only cooperate, but also profit from working with the state actors. I used to admire Google so much when it quitted China in 2010 for its upholding the corporate code of conduct, don't be evil. But I would say don't be naive if you ask how I feel about it today. As for the mass surveillance programs in China and the possible supportive role of both private and state-owned enterprises, 3 points need to be made here. First, limited information is known by the outside. I know nothing more than you do. Second, China apparently does not expect to be seen as an angel on this issue. Considering the mass surveillance programs run by the democracies in North America, Europe, and here in Singapore, China shall feel honored to be thought as capable as they are. Three, it is only based on speculation rather than credible evidence that Western governments have been accusing Chinese telecommunication equipment manufacturers of espionage for years. And increasingly, the cyberspace has been encroached upon through the submarine cables. Replacing electrical signal with light signal, fiber optical cables deliver data at much higher speed, with much greater capacity, with much better reliability, and at much lower cost. Since the first commercial submarine cables been laid in the 1850s, the submarine fiber optic cables have already become the foundation of the global telecommunication systems and the backbone of cyberspace. The world's reliance on a submarine cable is far beyond the imagination of common people, when many of them mistakenly assume that satellites are the primary medium. Cyberspace, in a physical form of submarine fiber optic cables, carries even greater value for trade than shipping goods through financial transaction and information. Presently, over 90% of them are carried on a relatively small number of submarine cables, which has tempted the most ambitious surveillance efforts of major powers, mainly the Western democracies, I should say. Intelligence collection targeting at submarine cables can be traced back to the 19th century and became prevalent during the Cold War. Today, cyberspace is more or less like an open ground for the intelligence collection activities of major powers. British officials have access to the majority of the internet and telephone communications flowing throughout Europe and in some cases reaching to the United States. The access to submarine cables gives English-speaking nations and their partners a stranglehold on communications across the Eastern atmosphere. For instance, France Telecom and China Telecom led one of the most important submarine cables in the world. This cable has 39 landing points in Western Europe, Middle East, South Asia, and East Asia. This cable is said to be bridged by NSA and GCHQ and Australia's Defence Signal Directorate at the landing point here in Singapore. It is believed that the government of Singapore has assisted its allied counterparts to tap the cable by taking a great advantage of its ownership of Singtel, the table's administrator. Likewise, contractors of cyber infrastructure may enjoy similar privilege. Worrying about the security implications, the English-speaking nations definitely don't like the idea of Chinese enterprises being such contractors. And as we can see, there is an unintended competition in cyberspace now between China and the countries we know. As planned under the BRI framework, China pledges to advance the construction of transnational optic cable standards through joint efforts. By improving international communication connectivity, China aims at contributing to social and economic development in a less developed world and benefiting from it, as long before proved by independent researchers. The internet drives economic growth. It is unaffordable for China to give up the opportunities to maximize prosperity through enhanced cyber connectivity. But in the eyes of some countries, it is only the control of cyberspace that China is after. Based on their own practice and experience, they should not be blamed for maintaining such opinions. Therefore, a competition in cyberspace turns out to be inevitable. To resist the economic and political influence in cyberspace from China, a few countries have launched a containment campaign against China in cyberspace. The wins and loses makes the competition a great drama. Within just 4 years till 2019, China's cable industry is projected to increase its market share from 7% to 20% also, ranking the third only after France and Switzerland. However, the growing presence of China's businesses has been repeatedly interpreted by the Western powers as seeking dominance in cyberspace and posing threats to cybersecurity. They never felt embarrassed of their own discourse being not supported by any concrete evidence up until now. Since January 2018, three incidents in this regard have just happened. Firstly, Nepal ended India's monopoly on its access to internet by embracing China's cyber connectivity project. As part of the bilateral cooperation under the framework of BRI, the fiber optic cable connecting Jiulong in China and Rasul Wagadi in Nepal ensures reliable high-speed internet service to more than 60% of its population. Second, Australian government blocked a Chinese enterprise from funding and constructing a submarine cable linking Sydney and Solomon Islands. Again, out of suspicion instead of concrete evidence. Three, Huawei's deal with AT&T to sell smartphones in the United States and Canada was written off, possibly due to the intervention of US government. To some industry analysts, this is more like a trust issue, a political issue. And I would like to say something about cyber sovereignty and global governance as proposed by China as a solution to this stalemate. During the World Internet Conference in December 2017, President Xi Jinping reaffirmed the doctrine of cyber sovereignty as China's solution for internet development. Cyber sovereignty is defined as government's desire to exercise control over internet within their own borders, including political, economic, cultural, and technological activities. It is the belief of the leading Chinese experts that the utopian notion of anti-sovereignty is not conducive to ensure stable and orderly development of cyberspace. In Chinese perception, a lack of safeguards would not only slow down growth for consumers and businesses, but also encourages widespread of mass surveillance and dominance in cyberspace by the leading industrial powers, which are often hypocritical over internet freedom issues. If the very existence in a virtual space and the realistic space belongs to the same group of peoples and same group of states, it becomes pointless to apply different sets of basic regulatory rules. As one of the main victims of cyber attacks and hacking, China understands perfectly well the importance of the universally recognized norms governing international relations, as well as in cyberspace. Since 2011, China has advocated the policy authority for internet-related public issues is the sovereign rights of states, which have rights and responsibilities for international internet-related public policy issues. At domestic front, cyber sovereignty shall allow states to set their own rules for cyberspace and exercise control over cyber infrastructure, data, and activities within their sovereign territory. At international front, China supports the Charter of the United Nations to be enshrined as the basis to guarantee a peaceful and orderly cyberspace, rather than the dominance and the supremacy of a few leading industrial states. In addition, a global governance system that is broad-based, multilateral, democratic, in a true sense, and transparent shall also be established to address the common challenges to cooperation and security. Finally, I would like to come to my conclusions on this. There are three urgent issues need to be taken care of in relation to global governance of cyberspace and the cyber sovereignty. Firstly, the global governance in cyberspace should be incubated on collective decisions by global community on international rules over cyberspace. Currently, the United States obviously exerts too much influence over the governance of the internet. In other words, management of key resources such as internet addresses and domain names and the roles in addressing bulk communications and network security must be subject to UN governance. As per the amended version of international telecommunication regulations, 89 countries have signed the amended regulations. It should be recognized that the countries that did not sign the new regulations are supporting de facto monopoly over cyberspace in the name of protecting free and open internet. These countries are the United States, the United Kingdom, Japan, Canada, Germany, New Zealand, etc. Secondly, application of international law shall be established as a consensus to decide jurisdiction to prescribe, adjudicate, and enforce the law in cyberspace. Jurisdiction to enforce and adjudicate is usually limited to what the state can actually control and manage within their sovereign territory. But in the case of cyberspace, considering one state's ability to breach the sovereign territory of another through cyber connection, jurisdiction to prescribe is believed to include legal measures to protect the state both at home and abroad, prevent cyber attacks and the cyber espionage against the state, and so on and so forth. In this regard, a survey and deliberation of law of jurisdiction applicable to cyberspace should be a priority task of the global community. Thirdly, in relation to cyber sovereignty, a state is entitled to exercise control over cyber infrastructure, data, and cyber activities within its borders. While it is comparatively easier to exercise control over cyber infrastructure, the control over data and the activities launched from abroad turns out to be tricky and troublesome, especially when they are related to freedom and privacy of the state's citizen. Therefore, a universal standard to apply proper countermeasures to illegal and harmful cyber activities that is detrimental to the interests of states and their citizens shall be constructed through negotiations and consultations. It is not my intention to defend or blame cyber espionage carried out by the state actors of any country, because we all know how common this is in both democratic and authoritarian states. Unless they are incapable of it, my sense is that there is a fine balance between cyber sovereignty and global cyber governance, and the dependence upon the good conscience of a few elite industrial powers will not guarantee a solid ground for open and free cyberspace for eternity. In such a chaotic and fluid situation, the cyber connectivity plan of China's BRI may not only provide an alternative of cyber infrastructure for the nations, states along the Belt and Road, but also an opportunity for the global community to reconceptualize the governance structure of cyberspace. If you are not sure of it now, please give it more time. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Professor. Very good presentation. It's of course a burgeoning problem, but it's also that technical that you have put it across to us in a language that is understood by the layman, and particularly your conclusions with regard to global governance, application of law, and cyber sovereignty of infrastructure. Very good ones, I think, and thought. Next on my list would be our old Dr. Amitendu Palit, and he will speak to connectivity and politics. So, next one is
Thank you very much, Dr. Chowdhury, and I think I have the sort of odd distinction being probably the only speaker with slides. So, I don't know whether that's a distinction worth mentioning in as much emphasis as I want to. But I think there is an advantage, a distinct advantage in being the last speaker for this particular session where I'm talking about connectivity and politics. And I think the advantage is that by now we have really had a very extensive degree of conversation on several aspects of the Belt and Road, but the geopolitics of the Belt and Road, fortunately or unfortunately, remains very prominent in the entire context and the conversations that we are having. Now, in this particular presentation of connectivity and politics, it's an interest that we have in terms of the research that we are doing at the Institute of South Asian Studies to actually investigate the relationship as much as possible in terms of the available evidence with respect to the Belt and Road. Now, let's begin with the kind of popular notion that when it comes to the Belt and Road, it's expanding in a way which would eventually, if this initiative runs its full steam, lead to the establishment of a China-centric regional order. Now, that inevitably also draws attention to the fact that much of the investments in the Belt and Road would be focused not only from an economic perspective, but also from a perspective that would be distinctly geopolitical. I think that is an assumption that we are trying to test whether this assumption holds up. In the light of the data that we have available so far, and particularly in light of the investments that have come into the Belt and Road till now, and let's also keep a note of the fact that the controversy over the Belt and Road has essentially arisen over the investments. And this is a point on which India has been a fairly outspoken critic. And there are other countries and agencies and conversations which are also contributing to the fact that investments and the way these investments are being designed and shaped and taken forward might not entirely be consistent with just a pure virtuous economic objective, but there might be more to it essentially in terms of geopolitical objective. So let's see if the data can help us in judging this to some respect. Now, what I show here in the beginning are Chinese investments in South Asia, and for this particular discussion, we restrict ourselves to South Asia. And we look at four countries of South Asia, which are Pakistan, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, and Nepal. We look at Chinese investments in South Asia during the period 2008 to 2016. And you would remember that the announcement of the Belt and Road actually came in October 2013. Now, since then, what we see is an increase in investments, as that circle part of the graph shows you out, that there has been a spike. But this spike, and it's a short period, it's a data for only 3 years since that announcement. We have numbers till up to 2016. Now, this is a spike, true, but then there is also a slight bit of a bottoming out. So, the first point to note is that we are looking at investments which are just barely into billions. 2016 is a period when you have $22 billion of investment, Chinese investment, in terms of output FDI that has moved into South Asia. So it's quite a substantive number of investment, but this investment will probably need to go up even more and more to actually match the size and scale of the Belt and Road that is being envisaged, at least in terms of the statements or the intentions that are coming out. So, 2013 was actually the time from when investments peaked into South Asia. And we are talking about Chinese investments. And we now move to the second interesting part, that where are these investments going? Now, this is where we have an overwhelming proportion of the investments having flowed into energy projects. Remember, again, we are looking at 2008 downward. 2008 downward, energy projects comprise 53% of the total Chinese investments that are flowing into South Asia, backed by other prominent sectors, including transport. There is a segment called technology, and we are using data from a database called the China Global Investment Tracker, which draws out information from the Chinese Statistical Yearbook on Chinese outward FDI, as well as other projects that are coming into it. So the prominent sectors are energy, technology, transport. Now, I must allude to the fact that when we look at transport, transport includes subsectors like shipping, aviation, so on and so forth, but it also includes Chinese investments in automobile assembly. So let's not be under the illusion that transport means only road building. That's not the case. It obviously includes investments in port and maritime infrastructure, but it's a more comprehensive category. But the interesting point to note is this great degree of concentration of investment in energy, and which would include hydro. There are companies like Three Gorges, for example, which have committed, which would include hydropower, and which would primarily also, till this point in time, according to the subsectors that we have seen, primarily includes investment in thermal plants powered by coal across the region. Now, let's look a little bit more closely at these energy investments across South Asia. Again, 2014 onward, there is a spike, a clear spike which shows that from around $5.8 billion in 2014, you have had this going up to $12.1 billion. But let's also remember this $12.1 billion pretty close to the Chinese investment in energy projects that was achieved in 2013. An interesting point, and as we go along, 2013 was actually a robust year for investments when it comes to Chinese funding into Southeast Asia. Since then, the funds have come back. 2014 was a dip, 2013 was a robust year. But it might be interesting to note that why was 2013 such a peak? And why hasn't that peak always been scaled back in the subsequent years that we are getting to see? 2014 onwards, 15, 16 onwards. And when we go into the energy subsector and look at the sectors a little more closely, as you see, the prominent sector, as I mentioned earlier, is coal. 36% of Chinese energy investments are going into coal. And I remember in the morning session, there was a question on Chinese investments and connection of these investments to environment and environmental standards. Now, clearly what we can at the outset assume is that coal-fired plants are not really going to be environmental friendly when it comes to the pure, simple logic of carbon emissions. It's a different matter that they can be empowered with technologies which minimizes emission, but nonetheless, they are not investments which are upfront environment friendly. Of course, there are other investments that we see are featuring pretty prominently. There are alternative energy source investments as well. There are investments in the oil sector, but primarily till now, the share of investments has been more for the fossil fuels. So there is a concern with respect to the kind of environmental issues these investments might probe as we go up. Looking closely at transport now. Transport, the overwhelming category is very interesting. It's autos. Now, when we look at roads, roads are not featuring as a subcategory. So when we talk about connectivity, it's probably a little bit myopic to consider just in terms of road building. There's a great degree of connectivity that comes in through the non-road segment. Particularly, I allude to my previous speaker's conversations on cyber connectivity, which till now the data has not been particularly exhaustive in catching. But when we look at segments like aviation, for example, or rail or shipping, the point to be noted over here is that shipping comes second to the auto sector. The auto sector includes investments in automobile assembly as well as road infrastructure building. And these also include investments which are not just greenfield, they also include acquisitions. They also include acquisition of existing assets. So there is a fairly significant spread and depth within the category of investment. So the Belt and Road connectivity plan that is shaping out as of now within South Asia is not just road building. There's a lot more to it. I think that's a point which is worth noting. We begin with a little bit of a scanning of the individual countries over here, and we start with Sri Lanka. Again, Sri Lanka, the same trend as it is getting reflected earlier. 2013 was a fair bit of a robust year. In Sri Lanka's case, there was a little bit of increase in 2014 to $2.8 billion, then a dip, and then again a recovery. So the investments in Sri Lanka primarily, and this is of course not a surprise, 58% in the transport sector. And this 58% would primarily include a lot of investments that have gone into shipping. We see a fair bit of investment in real estate. We see a fair bit of investment in energy and also in tourism. This doesn't change too much, I think, if we go into Nepal or whether, no, again, transport, very, very prominent in Nepal. In fact, almost 70% of the Chinese investments into Nepal 2008 onward have been in the transport sector. So I think when it comes to the question of building all-weather roads at high altitude, connecting the Himalayas as part of the Belt and Road, the evidence is pretty much clear that there's a huge amount of it. But the interesting part is over here. If you look at the time trend on the top, now till 2014, Nepal had received only $250 million of investments, Chinese funds. There's a huge spike in 2015. I think as we go along, there are these interesting years that become prominent. Why is 2015 seeing a spike in Nepal? I mean, is it a question of Nepal having emerged in some respects as a more priority location in the rest of South Asia, so much so that greater attention, investment attention, gets to focus on Nepal? These are questions that further research can only address, but I think these are the points to be noted. And again, there's a downward trend from 2016 onward. Pakistan, 2008 to 2016. And this is where the energy story really, really becomes robust. 68% in energy. Look at the contrast. Sri Lanka, core sector, core share, transport. Nepal, core share, transport. Pakistan, it changes to energy. And when we look at transport, transport is still pretty okay, 27%, but when there are conversations about the China-Pakistan economic corridor, I think that investment clearly points to the fact that, well, China-Pakistan economic corridor is an important initiative, but the Chinese investments in Pakistan are still much more in energy. I think that's a point that we have to live with as far as the data is concerned. The investments are far more in energy now. Whether the energy investments are getting subsumed within the whole China-Pakistan economic corridor or not is a different matter. That we will need to get a closer look at. Again, the kind of a bumpy ride from 2013 onward, an up and down in the category of investment. And finally, the last, Bangladesh. Bangladesh is the only country till now which shows a steady increase in the pattern of Chinese investments, and the peak has actually, the upward trend has started from 2014, but again it's energy which dominates. 55% in Pakistan's case, 68% here it's 55%, and there is a close jostling with transport. So maybe there are more investments that have been coming up over the last 2 to 2.5 years in maritime infrastructure and coastal infrastructure in China. So now, after all these tidbits, what do we finally end up with? there's no denying the fact that investments have picked up into South Asia since 2014. There's no denying. So the Belt and Road might have been a trigger for greater increase in investments. And investments have been of both varieties. There have been greenfield FDI, new projects, where fresh funds are going, and there have been substantive acquisitions of existing assets. So it's both. The data can be separated into greenfield and acquisitions, which will require me and my friend Chiahao much more work. But we can come back to you in the future on this. But as of now, it's a combination. But the point where I want to really draw your attention is this. In the conversation of the political economy of foreign investment in the world, and as we have seen across the world, when investors move into another country and the areas they seek up for investment can be divided into various categories. Let's say, for example, export-oriented investments. Let's say, for example, domestic market-oriented investments. And there is a major category called resource-seeking investments. From what we have seen till now, investments in energy and transport can be primarily clubbed into resource-seeking investments and market-oriented investments, because these are investments which give the owners of these investments control over resources. I think that's an important point to be noted. This is not similar to investment in organized retail operations. This is where the investor gets strategic control over the resources, like energy resources, like transport resources. Now, whether that has a political connotation or not, ladies and gentlemen and friends, no comments from my side. I just want to academically establish the character of this investment. Now, let's look at another aspect of this, which kind of fits into the political economy of it. And remember, we are looking at four South Asian countries and China. The pattern that we have seen till now does represent a win-win situation for all the parties involved. It's not a win-lose combination. Minister Han referred to in the morning as a particular development in terms of the macroeconomics of China. China's outward FDI is now more than the investment that comes into the country. So China is now a net investor in the rest of the world, not a net recipient of investments. Now, once that happens, obviously that investment is guided by certain motives. A, commercial motives. B, non-commercial motives. We can discuss and debate. Now, this is obviously a profitable opportunity for China, because for most of us who have been following the Chinese investment literature, we are aware of the fact that internally within China, the rate of return on investment has been slowly going on to a decline, onto internal investments. So there is clearly a greater commercial and economic urge to go outside and search for projects which will yield greater returns, which is a perfect economic rationale. So if that rationale is driving projects in these four South Asian countries, it's a win-win combination with respect to China. It's a win-win combination for the recipient countries as well, because these are important funds which are moving into important sectors for creating modern assets which are A, making best commercial use of the available natural resources, and also building new assets. So it's a win-win combination. Now, for recipients, more investment for more public goods, for China, access to resources and markets, and also in this entire scheme of things, what you now see is that if you visualize this in terms of Chinese investment moving into energy, moving into shipping, moving into goods, moving into a part of connected real estate, it actually creates the vision of a production network of trade and investment that is gathering momentum, creating shape between China and the four South Asian countries. So in a sense, it's a supply chain. A regional supply chain is coming up. This is a supply chain which is largely managed and dominated by China, because it's primarily the Chinese funds that are working towards it. Now, the point over here is, what is the politics in all this?
Well, I think as of now, the only surmise that we can make, and this is where we are moving into a zone of surmise, is that the politics needs to be identified, or rather the specific nature of the politics needs to be identified for the character of the project funding. I think resource-seeking investment is clearly an intention that we identify. Ownership of these resources on part of the overseas investors does give control over strategic assets in recipient economies, no denying this. But the point over here is that that does not mean that those investments should not come. Otherwise, countries would not have opened up their strategic resource sectors to 100% foreign investment. Many countries have. So the question is that when these resources are being commercially utilized through foreign investment, does that particular investment proposal in connection with the project involve issues which are determined more by political objectives than other objectives? Now the answer to that is also going to provide an answer to the fact, the question that India had raised, a question that in some conversations in the European Union has been pointed out, maybe Australians are leading to it. I'm not even getting into the US conversation on this, is that is there a trade-off between these investments and strategic autonomy for recipients? I think the answer to that has to be found by looking at individual projects. Till now, the available data at a macro level, at a big picture level, does not enable us to draw that conclusion. But I think individual projects, once looked at carefully, can address this issue. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Palit. You used your 20 minutes of glory rather well, I should think. I mean, at times fairly direct, most times subtle, and at all times to be read between the lines. Okay, so I will open the floor for questions. I will recognize Professor Mitra for starters. And thereafter, gentlemen, ladies, you will identify yourself. You don't leave it to the chair. What you represent, and make your questions or comments very brief. Professor Mitra.
Thank you, Chairman. My question is aimed at Admiral Dr. Colombage, but I think it would apply to the panel as a whole. Admiral, the chairman has, in his admirable opening words, summed up the reason why we are here. To quote him, he says, "We are in the China dream, a dream for a great, modern, prosperous socialist country which will produce high quality prosperity for all, for the benefit of all, and if it all goes well," that these are his words, "China would have earned the confidence of all."
Thank you for remembering.
Now, the BRI is the flavor of the month, but if you look at historically, have there not been similar efforts in the past? Think of the Roman Empire. They also built beautiful roads, some have survived to this day. At the height of colonial rule, France propagated La Nation Civile de la Thys, Pax Britannica also promised the benefits of science and technology for the whole of humanity. During the war, there was the Japanese co-prosperity zone, the German example best not talked about. And after the war, you have had the Warsaw Pact and the great American initiative of Marshall Aid, and now we have BRI. Often we have noticed these great initiatives which start claiming to produce benefit for all don't quite end up that way. So we have good reasons to be a bit skeptical. The two specific questions are, I'm very grateful to you for reminding us right at the outset, there is no such thing called pure economics. And Dr. Palit has nailed the hammer on the head by saying that let's look at every single transaction in terms of the politics that underpins the transaction. So the two questions are, have any studies been made of the investments so far that have been made, particularly in Sri Lanka, about the costs and benefits for the country itself, or as the chairman reminded us, for the natives? Second, now this is to Dr. Chowdhury, because he's a man of international organizations and has taught us a lot about international mechanisms which protect the rule of law. Can you think of any South Asian mechanisms to protect the interests of South Asia as a region, something that will come up later in the day, in terms of the costs and benefits of the BRI? Thank you.
Thank you. I think this question merits an answer, to be answered. You prove the adage, Professor, that when the Greeks used to say, to know what to ask is to know half the answer. So you probably know the answer yourself.
Thank you, sir, for your great insightful question, and I'm thinking my answer. Well, there is a reasonable debate even in Sri Lanka about investment coming from outside. The argument is governments take loan and people are made to pay. Whether is that the right model to follow? And if we can have the investment coming in and the project generate the money to pay for the investment, I think that's something we should really be looking for. Now, the irony is, especially if you take South Asia, for whatever reason, we have not been able to capitalize fully from the positives of globalization, economic liberalization, and we are kind of in the lower category of the world today. And also, if you look at South Asia, only 5% of GDP is regional, in the sense among the region. Now, I think in comparison, ASEAN is more than 20% GDP is within ASEAN. So what does that mean? That means we are least integrated and we are not developed region in the world. So how do we, are we going to maintain the same status quo into the future is one question. Do we have much choices is another question. Now if you take the case of Sri Lanka per se, we had a terrible war for 30 long years. Now if I take an opportunity to refer 1960s to Singapore, your honorable great Prime Minister Lee Kuan Yew said that we want Singapore to be like Colombo, and that was the 1960s. But then we have been retarded. The progress of our country has been stalled. And we have actually gone backwards, whereas the rest of the world or the rest of the region or the rest of the countries were going ahead. So we had a terrible war for 30 years, devastated the country, the social fabric, not much investment came in, no development in infrastructure. It was a very bad situation. So 2009 was a watershed event, May 19, the war ended. Now what? Are we going to wait another decade to develop ourselves? Are we going to wait another decade until all these major powers solve their problems and invest in our country? We had to do something. And then of course, when we opened the door, who came? Yes, India did come in a fairly big way. They built 10,000 houses, they built a rail track from Pawunia to north, they cleared mines. But all these projects were focused on the war-torn area only. So it was not really seen as for the country. And by that time, we lacked roads, lacked ports, lacked airport, everything. So then, China came into the scene. So in that sense, I don't think we had a choice, right? But having said that, I refer my comment to in the beginning, you know, the governments take loans and the people are made to pay. There is a debate going on even in Sri Lanka now. That's not the best way to go. We need to think of the project and then develop it. And then of course, Dr. Amitendu brought out a specific development. So from Sri Lankan point of view, I mean, now we keep debating about this Hambantota Port. I know personally it was offered to India to develop, but India did not come forward to develop. Now the port of Colombo South expansion port, three container terminals had to come. Who came? Only China came.
And today, now I'll tell you, sir, this Colombo International Container Terminal, which is 1 kilometer long terminal operated by China, is the only container terminal in that huge port. Now we are debating to develop the other two ports, other two terminals, like the east and the west terminal, and still not got off the ground. So this is the reality of situation in countries like Sri Lanka, right? So we need investment. We don't have much choices. We cannot really pay a lot of attention to the strategic concerns of the investor, but we need to be careful. Yes, we need to be very careful, and I think we are learning to be careful. Like even when the Hambantota, the debt equity came, we were completely bowled out in the beginning, but then later on, because of Indian pressure, because of the thought process in the country, we became more careful. And then now, I mean, to share with you, the Hambantota port, Sri Lanka Navy is in charge of security, totally. So nothing can happen against India in Hambantota port, that much guarantee I can give you. I mean, to eliminate any fears. So then Southeast, South Asian mechanism, that's my contention also, regional problems, regional solutions.
Yes, regional problem, regional solutions, of course, but also no need to throw up your hands in despair if there is no integrated response. Because all South Asian countries, 8 of them, probably have their own speed of development or whatever, there are 8 different speeds perhaps. And every country, every sovereign entity in South Asia will behave in accordance to its own perceived national self-interest. Therefore, if it is not integrated, no need to be concerned. Each one will find its own way towards development and progress. Might I take just one more minute to react to something else that was stated earlier in the morning, since Bangladesh does not feature in one of these items today. But I'd like to make this point very clear. We talked of predatory investments earlier in the morning, or predatory aid. You know, initially Bangladesh was considered a donor's darling, because Bangladesh was able to utilize its aid in the best possible way, despite the fact that in the 70s, all of you will recall that there was a huge body of literature emanating largely from Latin America called the Dependencia School, which argued that if you go into that aid kind of relationship, you will deepen your dependency on the donors and create a structural dependency situation. There was a German book called Todliche Hilfe, which means a deadly aid, and that was a warning to Bangladesh. But by the turn of the millennium, Bangladesh reduced its dependency, in fact, only 3% annually, 1% were banks, 1% European Union, and 1% Japan. Today it is hoped that this huge Chinese investment that is coming, $24 billion in connection with the DRI and also other projects into Bangladesh, which is needed. You need this input of this huge externally mobilized resources. Now, but of course, as Dr. Palit was saying earlier, the project to project, of course, this has to be monitored very, very carefully. And we believe, as Pakistan, as Sri Lanka and Bangladesh, we have the intellectual capacity to be able to do that. Last week, and I think this point was about to be made earlier this morning, but it wasn't quite. There was one project in which a Chinese firm was blacklisted in Bangladesh. Though Bangladesh and China are all-weather friends, strategic friends, but in that, it was understood by both countries that Bangladesh sort of monitored the working of this firm and blacklisted it for reasons for not conforming to the received mores of international dealings. Therefore, you see, it will not probably be predatory, but one must leave it to the recipient donor. It's not a donor in this case, but partner relationship. And hopefully, we will somehow muddle through. Rajiv.
Thank you, sir. My question to, I have two questions, one for Dr. Jayanath and another for Professor Huang. To you, you, in your concluding remarks, mentioned and again answering questions said regional solutions for regional problems. But we know that today's challenges are more across the region. So, for example, a natural disaster or other non-traditional security threats. So, how do you see that? And second, in which region do you see China? Is it part of East Asia, South Asia, or Southeast Asia? To you, Professor Huang, very well presentation on cybersecurity. You talked about global governance. What I was surprised, I didn't hear from you, cybersecurity governance with Chinese characteristics. Normally, that features in all important documents which emerge from China. And that has been very well captured, I think, by Professor Ian Hall, where he says that Chinese Communist Party wants same deal with the world as it offers to its people. Don't criticize, don't oppose, don't push for political reforms, and we will ensure you are prosperous. Your views on that. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for a very interesting question. Well, I mean, when I look at it, especially the threats from the non-state actors, I would say they are pretty much regional. I mean, within the region. So therefore, we can exclude the extra-regional big powers in tackling the non-state actor security threat. But on the other hand, the state versus state rivalry is pretty much influenced by the outside powers. So, if I may ask a question back from you, do you prefer to have a maritime Cold War in the Indian Ocean and the Western Pacific? Or you want to consciously avoid a situation where we actually go into a maritime Cold War? Now, if I recall, I made the point that there are many issues that we are grappled with, like food security, poverty elimination, environmental impact. But then our focus is utilize the money for military development. We want to build 300 ships, 200 ships, 3 aircraft carriers, acquire submarines. Yes, it is okay to have them, but then is it the real required thing? So that is what I said. When you have external players, this Cold War, the maritime Cold War, prospects are increasing. If you really look at it, it's not really a regional maritime Cold War. What is the interest of extra-regional powers in this region in creating a maritime Cold War? To me, it is detrimental. So as long as we are divided, as the chair said, as long as we are not integrated in any meaningful manner, we open the door for outsiders to come. This is again a very common phenomenon. So that is the danger I was referring to, and that is why I kept referring. We have ASEAN, we have IORA, we have IONS. IORA and IONS are Indian initiative. ASEAN is ASEAN initiative. Now, then you ask a second question, where is China in that? China is, I believe, in the Indian Ocean. To be fair with China, China was not in large numbers in the Indian Ocean before 2009. But Chinese merchant fleet was humbled by the pirates. Now, could one particular country handle the menace of pirates in the Indian Ocean? Could a small grouping of countries handle the situation in the Indian Ocean? No. There had to be 3 task groups, and many individual navies were invited by the United Nations to come into the Indian Ocean. Yes, it is true, now the piracy is near zero, but they are there. So, China is there, and now, of course, China is interested in maintaining energy security. So is Japan, so is South Korea, so are some of the ASEAN countries, so is Australia interested in trade. So, my argument is, we need a free and fair maritime situation in the Indian Ocean to pave the way for freedom of maritime commerce.
Yes, Shah Mishra. Yeah, that's okay. And
Thank you for your question, and I think it's a very good one. Here, I would like to indicate the full emphasis that Chinese government has proclaimed as the basis of the cyber governance. It is a broad-based government system that China is supporting. And the four principles that we are in favor of is the respect for cyber sovereignty and maintenance of peace and security, and also promotion of openness, and finally, the construction of good order. Apparently, we have a different understanding about good order in cyberspace within our borders and beyond our borders. And if you are trying, if you are kind of concerned whether China will impose its understanding of good order in cyberspace, say for impose certain restrictions about on the freedom of speech or things like that upon people in other parts of the world, I think it's a really far-fetched concern. You really don't have to worry about it, and there's nothing to hide. There are restrictions in the cyberspace in China, but don't worry. Chinese people are very smart. If they want to use the Google or other services, they can manage. And you just don't worry, all right?
Okay, Anish Mishra, be very, very brief, and then you, sir. Professor, so we have three in line. Anish, you, sir.
Okay. Okay, I have two very short questions. Okay, the first question is that if you look at the world history and in the yesterday years, the policy of the colonial masters to divide and rule, but China's colonialism is unite and rule. That's why we are talking about, you know, about connectivity, bring all the countries bring all the countries closer to each other. And the thing is that. But by this, if you look at the rise of China, China has risen in the post-colonial world. So the Marxist ideology itself goes against maintaining colonies and economic exploitation. But as Paul Krugman says, China is ruled by the Communist Party, but its practice is one of crony capitalism. Okay, my question is very short. I just want to know from the panel, how can South Asian countries or the countries under the Belt and Road Initiative resist becoming a client state of China? The second question is a very short. Okay, it's really short. Okay, the second question is that the thing is that we know that that Americans are against the One Belt One Road Initiative. So is India. I just want to know from this panel whether you actually acknowledge that there are elements in this world, particularly America and India, that actually want to sabotage whatever we are discussing today, the Belt and Road Initiative. And is there a recognition for it? And what is being done to actually fight against this? Thank you.
Hi, Sanjeev Ayer. I have a question in the context of sovereignty and security and from a governance point of view. So, actually,
general
it's general and I'll get specific as well. So, in answer to one of the previous questions, the answer seems to be, trust us, we are not going to do anything negative or dangerous. That in a multilateral, multi-country kind of mechanism, for just on a trust basis, the trust us, we are not going to do it. In fact, that is how colonizations have happened in the past, that it starts probably with benevolent intent, but leads on to something. So the specific question is, in this scenario where the initiative is led by one country, how is the governance model going to work? So it is all right when Amitendu spoke of a win-win model and a specific project context. But how exactly is the governance model going to work when it is led by one country? So this could be a more intense form of, say, current United Nations Security Council model, where the permanent members wield a lot of power, and this is getting into a scenario where not even it's X number of members, it's just one. So how exactly is the governance model going to work? So probably the question is specific to Professor Huang, but it's open on the win-win aspect of that, maybe I'm thinking. Thank you.
Thank you very much. You see, actually, I have a few words, a few comments for the previous three speakers. Thank you very much for your excellent presentations. You see, the BRI is a Chinese proposed initiative, and it's going to be an international consensus, and it's gradually become the international actions, and it will become international benefits at the end of the day. Whether you accept or not, because we Chinese welcome any country interested in this BRI to participate for the mutual benefits of both your country and the nation, the common people. I have traveled frequently to both South Asia countries and Southeast Asia countries. What do the nations need urgently is the improvement of the infrastructure. Actually, in this regard, I think Singapore has played a very important role in helping the Asia countries in improving this trade, investment, and overseas infrastructure. I remember very clearly in the early 1980s and the 1990s, we China have a slogan that to learn from Singapore. Because the former leader of Lee Kuan Yew visited China frequently. So most South Asia people and East Asia people, especially some backward countries, they ask it frequently, what are the most successful experiences of Chinese success for over the past 40 years? I will tell you, actions speak more than words. Just, I fully agree with Admiral, your regional solution to regional problems. That is, when we face challenges and opportunities, whether you choose the opportunities or you choose the challenges, because nothing can be perfect. You can improve everything during your actions. If you wait and wait until everything is perfect, you cannot do anything, right? Right, actions speak more than words, more than words. So that is the key point I want to share with you in the afternoon about the China-Myanmar bilateral economic corridor, the whether it is the multilateral corridor or the bilateral corridor, because we have 6 economic corridors under BRI. And now we have this bilateral economic corridor, both with Laos and with Myanmar. Because some countries are very slow to respond to this BRI. Because the opportunities is there. Okay. So actions speak more than words. Thank you very much.
Address Salim's question, because I think you have actually highlighted the most important concept that's emerging in this conversation. But before that, I want to mention one small point which I thought I mentioned during my presentation, I forgot. You might recall that when we were looking at Chinese investments in South Asia, we are looking at the year 2016, the number was $22 billion. Now, this is actually a fairly small proportion of around $130 billion that is being talked about for the continent. And let's not forget that South Asia has been the most fertile recipient of Belt and Road investments. So the question is, where are the rest of the investments going? Are they going anywhere at all? Again, I leave this topic. The second point, simply on your governance question, I think let me compare the Belt and Road Initiative with the AII. And I would like to distinguish between an initiative which is led by an institution vis-a-vis an initiative which is led by a country. I think when it comes to an initiative led by an institution clearly fixes its goals. And there is a governance pattern that emerges from the goals, and that is reflected in the great degree of confidence which countries have shown in the AII. The biggest example being India is now the largest borrower from AII. Unfortunately, I think this governance and this confidence is yet to emerge in a country-specific initiative which is the Belt. So that is where the main challenge will be as we go ahead.
Okay, very quickly how we should handle this, and I think that's why I have been talking about the possibility of regional integration. And my contention is, if you leave a vacuum in the region, someone will fill it, and more or less, it will be an outsider. Now, while India has to come out with some new great policies, to my understanding, like neighborhood first policy, because India neglected the neighborhood beautifully. So they needed to come out with the neighborhood first policy. Why did India has to come out with Sagar policy, security and growth for all in the region? Well, that should be the way forward. If you only develop, leaving others behind, it will definitely lead to conflict. So in that sense, I think Sagar should be the way forward for South Asia. Security and growth for all in the region. Don't leave anyone. Right? So my contention is, if you leave a vacuum in your own region, somebody will fill it. Now, SAARC, very briefly, when we started SAARC, we had high hopes that it would contribute to regional integration, it would contribute to regional prosperity. We had SAPTA. Practically nothing has happened today. Why? Because of the mistrust between two key players in SAARC, India and Pakistan. So, unless we are able to resolve the differences, we are not going to go anywhere.
Thank you, sir, for your good question. And I think it is too early to presume that China will come after the United States as the dominant power in the cyberspace, because it's an obvious misunderstanding of the current contemporary scenario, because China now is fighting against the control or dominance of the United States in cyberspace. And so all of a sudden, their country is suspecting China's intention to control the cyberspace. As a matter of fact, China is not. And secondly, I think coming to the issue of governance of cyberspace, it is a global issue. It requires global solution. On this part, China has only one voice. And we are more than happy to hear what the other people is going to contribute to the global governance over cyberspace, not only by China.
Thank you. You there, sir? Yeah. You go, and then I'll recognize the ambassador of Costa Rica and all of
Yes, Lanka from Fortune Times, Chinese media. So my question, now in Indonesia, we are talking about GTT. So G is Gojek, and T is Traveloka, and another T is Tokopedia. So behind all them, the Gojek invested by Tencent and JD, and Alibaba invested Tokopedia, and JD, Jingdong also invested Traveloka. So when we talk about this cyber security, so all this e-commerce and new startups, now outside of China, they are using this China's technologies and standards. So can Professor Huang elaborate more from the more commercial angle about the cyber governance and standard of China?
Okay, last question, Ambassador of Costa Rica.
Sir, you have 4 points. Thank you. You can come back again later.
Thank you so much. Now, I just wanted to say I was very happy to hear Dr. Palit mentioning the environment aspect. I wanted to stress how important for the whole world this aspect is, and I don't know if the panelists could deliver on what are the views of the different actors when signing investment proposals with China, and also what is China's view on the environment as being a key element in all these proposals agreed. It is also a regional problem and it is a world problem, so I would encourage you to share more on what all this has been.
And maybe we can squeeze in there if you like.
Okay, thank you so much. And very brief, three questions. One, first to Ambassador Chowdhury. You mentioned about 24 billion of investment coming into Bangladesh. That's very good. And as much as investment comes, that's better. But what is this 24 billion? I am not able to find a clear indication anywhere in the public documents. On the other hand, India is giving 4 billion, but I can count every and every dollar that where the investment is. Second thing, again coming from transparency point of view to Amitendu sir, you mentioned about the spikes and you know interesting years. Are these interesting years also from the political point of view, like something happening at that particular point, say 2013 or 2015 in Nepal, and the investment going in that direction? I think we have to look into that aspects also. And coming to Admiral, let me tell you that as I was mentioning in the morning, that it's not the only one lamp or one game going on. In fact, in India, you please reassure from me that Western Indian Ocean and Eastern Indian Ocean both have one thing common, that is India itself. We have Eastern Seaboard and Western Seaboard, and the Sagar Mala and Bharat Mala project that we are developing, the ports and the road network, that's more than 200 billion of development going on in India itself. So this will also be a very major thing when it comes to the Indian Ocean. And last thing about regional cooperation, thank you so much for highlighting it. And India in fact is going ahead with old concepts of growth quadrangle, which once upon a time in June Dubai mentioned. So we are also going ahead with regional cooperation and growth quadrangles. And Ambassador Chowdhury himself will be able to tell what sort of cooperation going on between India's Northeast and Bangladesh as far as net connectivity and support sector is concerned.
Very good. So we have a few remarks. Would you like to continue a little bit? Admiral,
new
professor, and
I'll wrap up. No, I'm just taking this question about the years and the spikes. Yes, it's true. I mean, till now, I have not been able to establish a conclusion. But I want to mention another point that in all the context of investments in the South Asian countries, 2016 has been a year when either the investment has dropped or it has bottomed out. And I think this has a connection to China's internal emphasis on bringing down public debt. Because what that essentially has meant is that it's become much more difficult for companies to mobilize loans from banks, because the banks are now becoming far too strict in extending loans. And that is having and going to have, as we call it, a reflection on the capital flow that is going out of China into a variety of investments. So I think this purely in terms of the DRI investments is a structural challenge which will need to be handled as the situation goes ahead.
Thank you, sir. Very briefly, yes, I am fully aware of Sagarmala project, and I think it's a great thing for India. In fact, I have been arguing that some northern and eastern ports in Sri Lanka should be made part of Sagarmala project, because if you really look at the geography, from your eastern coast to western coast, you have to go via Sri Lanka. So why not our underdeveloped posts in the east and north be part of Sagarmala? So I need not mention it purely, but I do understand it's a great interest. But then there is another side to it, the whole other initiative. Now take for example, Asia-Africa Growth Corridor. Is it purely to count the Belt and Road Initiative, or is it purely to connect Asia to Africa? So that's the question that we need to find answers. So are we going to be in another dilemma? We have DRI, we keep talking about it, and then the Asia-Africa Growth Corridor comes in. So how are we going to select? So I think what is
best for the region is great, and as you mentioned, the regional connectivity is very important, and we need to connect people. I mean, in fact, one of the most difficult visas for Sri Lankans to get is to go to India. Right? Why? Because we are, you know, we don't address that issue. Why are we restricting our people traveling back and forth within the region? And also not the region. It's not easy to get visa to Bangladesh for Sri Lanka. You have to have all that. I mean, not for me really. No, why do we need that much restriction among SAARC or the region? Why are we so worried about our own brothers across the other strait coming to our country?
Thank you for the question. I think the corporate policy for Jingdong, for Alibaba to advance their interests in Southeast Asia is to have their business localized here. So concerning the cybersecurity in terms, especially the data, I think there is another one, business giant in China named Xiaomi. This company has already moved its data center to India to take care of their local operation. And this model can be followed if you are concerned of cybersecurity and use application of the data. I think if Southeast Asian countries are interested to take advantage of the e-commerce model of China, you can put forward your requests, and if Chinese undertakers is willing and can cater to your requests as per the regulations and laws in Southeast Asia, why not? There's no question of that. Thank you.
Okay, I will now conclude this session, but before I do that, just one or two small remarks in reaction to some of the points also raised. I thought this was an extremely stimulating discussion, but no discussion on a subject like this is ever open. I mean, you will continue to have questions, you will continue to have views, etc. But the most important thing that such a deliberation or discussion does for us is to stimulate our curiosity. I mean, we reflect on the points raised, and that is an invitation to reflection more than anything. With regard to your numbers, I'm not very sure what the exact numbers are, but I reflect what the stated positions of many of the public leaders who have spoken to the subject is. But my main concern today was whether we become indebted to these investments. Mr. Muhyiddin, who is the finance minister, told me that he is not concerned. You see, Bangladesh doesn't have a problem with demonetization, as you are aware. He does not see this as a concern. Nor does Mr. Sardar Aziz of Pakistan, that's a different ballgame altogether. But it's not seen as a concern, and they feel that it's better to have these investments than not to have them. And in any case, as you are well aware, there are strong Chinese encroachments in many segments of the Bangladesh system, not just the economy, but also the societal spectrum. And so that influence is there, but one has to be very careful when one deals with all these global, the new emerging global interactions, particularly in the economic sphere, that your sovereignty is not infringed. So that we have to be careful about. Thank you very much, audience, for your participation, very, very enthusiastic participation. We are very pleased, and may I invite all of you to lunch and thereafter to meet at a point in time which I think will be
thank you. Thank you, Dr. Chowdhury. We would now like to invite Dr. Chowdhury to present our tokens of appreciation to our distinguished speaker, Admiral Dr. Jayanath, Colombage. And Associate Professor Huang, Yunsong. Thank you. We would now like to invite all of you to a lunch reception in Ballroom 2. Please be back here by 1:35 p.m. for the next panel session. Thank you.